at a hostel right now. So I'm kind of like the knowledgeable person. So all of these foreigners keep talking to me. They're from England, these people. So
that's awesome.
Yeah. I was telling Dave before everybody got on that I did this like little portrait today.
I caught a glimpse of it a minute ago. That is super awesome.
Yeah, I did it as a thank you for the person that I stayed with the first month I was here. And that's a portrait of her, because she was looking for, you know, a self-portrait. Or not a self-portrait, but a portrait of her.
Yeah.
And so I did it, and I did it in, like, 2 hours or something today. It's, like, a little 5-inch by 5-inch canvas.
Wow.
And, yeah, everybody's all like, wow, that's so cool. I want one.
That is recording, cool. By the way.
What up, Dave?
We are recording, by the way, just so you...
That's fine. I'm waiting until Brenda gets off the phone so we can actually, like, have a group dynamic. So I'm just talking about stuff.
Sorry, but guys. Yeah, though.
Brenda!
Sorry.
Happy and understandable.
What's that?
Okay.
Am I able to be understood?
Partially. I heard partially. Understood.
Anyway,
I want to hear you.
I just wanted, just trying to let you before the last thing that when Katerina did last week, she helped out a friend of mine and did their thing.
Huh? Is he going to write it?
I wish I could hear you, but it's so choppy.
It gets really choppy, Dave. Anyways,
sorry.
Hopefully he'll write it. He was talking about his friend Kristen and how like last week she was listening in on our call just on the viewer line and how, you know, the stuff that we discussed and went through was really helpful and pertinent to her. And
that's great.
That we're making a difference in other people's lives and we didn't even realize it.
Hey, that's what it's all about. That's awesome.
Yeah, isn't that cool?
That feels wonderful.
Yeah. So, Brenda.
Yes.
Are you all caught up? I think I asked you that.
I did read chapter 4, and I started chapter 5, but I haven't got through it yet.
Okay, but you got through chapter 3 and everything, too?
Yes.
Okay, because, yeah, Happy and I, we discussed that last week pretty in-depth.
Yes.
I think Dave recorded it or something, but...
Yeah, sorry, I was traveling on that Sunday.
No, it's okay. Life happens.
Yeah.
We're all kind of, like, spirited artists.
Life happens this week. Woo!
Yeah! Let's do some check-ins. How is everybody doing?
You know, this reading thing, woo! I'm being a survivor. I'm just going to survive. I've got till tomorrow. That's when I started last Tuesday of no reading for a week, and almost felt for a moment like, what is my life worth? Oh my gosh.
It's that important.
Yeah, it's like, I read every day. I really do. I read, but you know, it's stuff that keeps me going in my, you know, direction, in my spiritual direction. And so to not have that every day, I kind of felt lost. I was like, you know, because I read things that inspire and uplift me, and, you know, a chapter a day of one book and affirmation after affirmation. So it was like, oh my goodness. So really, I'm not even kidding. It's been one of the toughest weeks for me in a long, 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 long time.
Well, it looks like you've been having some fun. I see your braids in your hair. At least you've been entertaining yourself.
Yes, that's important. Very important at this point.
I bet your nails are really cool colored as well.
No, I haven't.
Wanted to dye your hair a bunch.
Yeah, you know, and I've got to go get some more hair color, but it's just, you know, woo. Yeah, it's, you know, it's all worth it, though. Even if I can't see, like, what am I learning? Oh, gosh.
What have you been doing with all of your time that you haven't been What have you been doing with all of your time that you have not been reading?
Reading? Okay, well, I started to paint, and I was super inspired to paint and everything, and then I got to a point where it was like, I can't finish the painting because to do what I want to do with it, I have to look up some, you know, do a little research, and that causes me to read. So I just sat there, and I'm like, I'm not even going to finish it. I'm so mad. It's right here. And I was like, I'm not even going to go any further because I don't know what to do with it. I was just like, bah. I lost all motivation for it, which is like, no, it's not what I wanted. But, you know, it's going to work out. It's going to work out.
Oh, that's so funny, Happy. That's so funny. You're like being a total extremist about it. That's like insane.
Yeah, I was rebellious.
No, I mean, it's not bad. It's not bad. You know, it reminds me, I did a Vipassana retreat in 2011, and I didn't read or talk for 9 days. It was
insane. Oh, my. Wow.
My brain was so active, though. It's like, I couldn't draw. Like, there were literally rules. I could not have a journal or a pen on me. So it was like, there were so many ideas that I wanted to capture, but I couldn't.
Wow. And what did you learn from it? Like, what did it bring to you?
What it really brought to me was that that everything's really fleeting and transitory. And
wow.
Do you need to get that?
I think he ran off. It's my 4-year-old or 5-year-old.
Oh, okay. But yeah, just the fact that everything is really transitory and fleeting, and, you know, these thoughts that stress us out and these things that really, like, are badgering us, like your thoughts of, you know, you feel like you were going to die because you couldn't read, you know, it's like you're wanting to escape, you know, it's like, it's even though it's like a positive escape, it's still an escape, you know?
Yeah.
And that's what I really think is very interesting about this week, you know, this idea of recovering a sense of integrity. And, you know, getting deeper into our emotions and what they're actually telling us rather than, like, this bullshit story that we've told ourselves, oh, I'm okay, you know?
Yeah.
And then we, like, try to mask over it with all of the affirmations without really looking at how we're feeling.
Yes. Yep.
And so I think that's why you're feeling really uncomfortable without the affirmations because that's, like, a mind shift, right? It's something to escape the feeling that you're feeling.
Yeah, truly.
And so you're actually having to sit with your actual feelings. But the idea...
I think I better get it real quick. Sorry.
Okay. I'll hold on for a second.
1 second.
Flexibility, right?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Brenda.
Yes.
How are you doing?
I'm doing okay, actually. It's been it's been kind of a tough couple of weeks. I have fibromyalgia, and it's just been kicking the crap out of me with all this cold weather and storms. So I just want to lay down and sleep all day.
Would you believe it? I actually suffered fibromyalgia when I was 18.
Really?
I suffered it for a year and a half, and it's in remission now, so I've been in remission for, you know, since I was 19, 20, so I'm 21 now, so for the past 2 years I've been in remission, but yeah, this book is
all
actually what
now,
helped
Katie
me start
in
to
the
go
room.
To remission.
What's that? Sorry?
I said this book is actually what started to help me go into remission, because dealing with all the emotional shit that was stressing me out and causing all of the pain that manifested itself physically.
Mm-hmm.
So, can you hear me better with my video off?
Dave, you're interjecting in weird times. I thought he was gone. Oh, Dave. He's a funny character. I appreciate him. Happy.
Sorry.
Can you hear me now?
I can.
Okay. But yeah, so you got to meet your, like, your true feelings this week, right?
Yeah. Yep. And I wanted to just knock him out.
To smack him upside the head.
Yeah. It was quite interesting.
Happy got to meet her not so happy feelings, right?
Uh huh. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I guess more times like this would be beneficial, you know, spread out over, you know, a little bit of a time frame. But, you know, I know it had a purpose, even if I can't really grasp it all right now. That's why I stuck with it and said, you know, even if, you know, I took this course and I'm determined to do all of it. You know, I promised myself to complete it in every way. So, you know, this I know has value. Even if I don't recognize it at this moment, it does. So.
Well, yeah. I mean, I've had quite a bit of my own crap this week, too. Just in and out. Like, I didn't... I've used it as fuel, though.
Mm-hmm.
So I've been doing a lot of writing. Like, way above and beyond the 3 pages that I normally commit to every day.
Mm-hmm.
I'm flipping through my journal to look for the drawings, but they've been some pretty dark shit, like this one. Like a puppeteer, like somebody is controlling me.
Yeah, that is awesome.
But it's really dark, and it says, consider this a warning. Don't bother wasting your time if you're trying to change me. You know, like, kind of talking about, because, you know, the relationship thing is still spinning around in my head a lot, because that's, like, the most prominent pressing issue that I've had on my mind. And I've been thinking a lot about, you know, just this idea of being myself and allowing myself to actually be myself and not get escaped, or not to escape into a relationship or to lose myself in that, which is like the pattern that I normally would get into when I'm in a relationship with somebody. And, you know, being with people who are domineering and trying to change you, and people who think that they know better for you, and the things that actually really crush your creative spirit, right? Just things that are not good for you, not good for your heart, not good for your soul.
Yeah.
And so I've had a lot of, like feelings of being, like, the warrior for myself, the warrior, the champion of my own life. And that's really where the darkness is coming from for me. It's like this strong feeling of just wanting to be in control of my own life and not to let... Oh, lost happy. I was talking too much. Yeah. That's funny. I promise I paused. I paused right when you fell off.
Oh, yay, thank you.
You're welcome.
I was like, where did y'all go?
Yeah. I also did this drawing called The Weary Warrior. I don't know if either of you saw this on Facebook.
No, I didn't. Oh, wow. Wow, that's very awesome.
That's cool.
Well, it's easier to see with the actual picture in front of you, but, like, it's been more just, like, this is what... Okay, let me gather my thoughts for a second. I'm really distracted by Brenda's typing.
Sorry.
This is what I'm...
Talking to Dave.
These are my thoughts. Yeah, I'm sure Dave is very chatty right now. Oh gosh. All right. So yeah, Happy, right before you got off the call, I was talking to Brenda and you and saying that, like, yeah, the darkness that I'm feeling is like this feeling of really wanting to be my own champion, and the feelings that I've felt in not being my own champion and being a victim, and these heavier feelings, but through that experience of feeling those heavy feelings, this inner warrior has been surfacing. She's been surfacing in my artwork lately. She's been surfacing in my writing, like kind of like this archetype. And, you know, that's really like the place where you can start to explore the different voices, the different themes that are happening as well. So rather than shunning it and being like, oh my God, this is so dark and scary, you can really step into it and understand like where those voices are coming from and where those emotions are coming from. Because you probably have an inner warrior in you too that's like being like, oh my gosh, I want to be the champion because this is like, this stuff that I'm feeling absolutely sucks. And I feel really repressed and suffocated and all of these things. And those are the icky feelings, but they're not a way, you don't need to run from them though.
Yeah, it does feel like it though. Yeah. Feels like I've got to run.
Can you tell me a little bit more in detail? Because, I mean, you're really good at being general about all this stuff, but I think that it would be really enlightening if you could share with us like a little bit more detail about what it is that you're actually experiencing.
Well, what part? I'm going through an entire like rebirthing phase, so I mean, there's so much to tell. We could be here for hours. That's why I'm as general as I can about it. Because in some moments, it's just like, it's a bit overwhelming, you know, in this rebirthing, because I feel really lost a lot, you know, right, over the last 4 weeks. Just because I guess I've been real good at being general. And that has, you know, led me to here, to where I want to pull more from myself, but I'm not allowing it at the same time. And so when it does come up and surfaces any little bit, it's just like almost too scary to keep going in that direction. So even writing, and I'll be honest, when I started to draw some things the other day, I was like, oh my gosh, I can't draw that because it doesn't feel good. And if I look back at this and I see it, it'll take me to that low feeling disc that I don't want to be on. And so I'm in a battle with myself about what I should and shouldn't write. And so, you know, it's...
Oh, I'm so excited yeah. that you told me about this, because I actually went through this.
Really?
The first time that I went through the artist's way, I was in this like total Abraham Hicks mode of just wanting to be positive all the time. And,
yes. You know,
Dave can tell you that like it was crazy, but I was judging my negativity. So I had a lot of negative charge about negativity. And so
yes.
I was already on that low flying disc. But if I started giving myself permission to go there and to have some humor and some ease with my negativity, and it lifted, and there was no longer the negative charge with it. And so I gave myself permission to draw the most horrid, horrific, painful drawings. Yeah. And you know what's funny? At the end of it, I was laughing.
Really?
Yeah. So it's not the way that you think it is. It's really not. Because when you allow yourself to have those emotions and to experience that stuff, it doesn't have any hold on you. It's like the Velcro is just gone.
Yeah. Yeah, I can feel that when you're saying that. I felt that relief from hearing that. So,
yeah, I mean, like, the pictures that I've been drawing are not necessarily high-flying disc stuff,
mm-hmm.
but they're truthful. They're how I'm feeling.
Yeah.
And with giving myself the validation and the permission to feel those things, you can go to get it. Is what I'm saying making sense, Brenda?
Yes, it is.
Okay, cool.
Completely. Yeah, I was there a few years ago, so I know exactly what you're both talking about.
That whole, like, judging the dark stuff.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was a tough one, you know, with myself. I spent many hours in the shower screaming and crying the eyes out, right?
Mm-hmm.
Just to get rid of it, and
yeah.
But you just, you know, you have to allow yourself that time, right?
Yeah, you do.
And it's like you said, people will say, well, you know, you've got to be happy, you got to be happy, you got to be happy. But you know, sometimes it's just not possible. You know, it's just not.
No, and you know what's interesting, Happy, is that Abraham Hicks even talks about this, that you need to give yourself, you need to allow those feelings, and because they understand full well. I mean, they're not purporting that you should ignore your miserable feelings or anything like that. They understand that you can't get from there to there.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah.
But you can recognize, though, right, that it's your own fears of those feelings. It's not necessarily what you've been hearing. It's more so that you're just uncomfortable with going there.
Yeah.
Because you're afraid of losing control, and you're afraid of actually...
Yeah.
going into a dark place.
Well, that kind of happened this week, though. I mean, once I just said, okay, you know, I'm just going to let myself experience these feelings just a little bit. Mm-hmm. It was, and it's, you know, the law of attraction takes over, and all of a sudden I'm in this position. I'm like, oh, I don't even want to get out of bed. I was sleeping, like, even today I slept till noon. And, you know, usually I'll get up about 10 o'clock. And so I have, like, no desire whatsoever just to be up. And so I'm like, what is happening? But, yeah, so I let myself take, you know, go in that direction a little bit, and it was like, wow, it's, like, taking over, so I've got to do something. So it seriously feels like this little battle, like, you know what to do, and you're not doing it. But then at the same time, there's this stuff within me that I want to, you know, change, to truly change, not just to, you know, put, like, the happy face sticker over for a moment. I just want to actually change those things so that I can, you know, allow myself to be who I truly am and be okay with that in whatever moment it is. So, yeah, it right now it's like a little battle.
Mm-hmm. Dave said here that you can only feel great when you allow yourself to feel like shit.
Yeah. And that seems so opposite, but yeah.
No, because the funny thing is when you're actually allowing yourself to feel like shit, and Dave and I have gone through this a lot in the past 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's been one of my, like, teachers just about giving myself permission to feel bad. The funny thing is when you've actually given yourself permission to feel bad, yeah, you kind of burst into laughter and you start just kind of, like, realizing that you don't really want to feel bad. You have a choice. But first, before you make that choice, you need to give yourself permission to choose it.
Yeah.
Katerina, Dave said that you've been his teacher equally.
I know. Thanks, Dave.
That's awesome. It's true.
Yeah. But seriously, like, I know it's scary and you feel like you're going to be laying in bed for the rest of your life. And you're, like, never going to get up, and you're never going to take a shower, and you're, like, never going to do anything. But sometimes you got to let yourself just lay there. And it's one of the most healing things that you can do for yourself is just allowing yourself to do and be whatever you need to be in that moment.
Mm-hmm.
And not try to cajole yourself into being happy, because that's not real happiness.
Mm-hmm.
Real happiness comes from allowing yourself to be you.
Yeah. Very, very, very true. And then there was moments, little spurts here and there that I was like, oh, okay, you know, this feels good. But then it would just, like, fly away. And I'm like, no, come back. And I'm all grabbing, trying to get those moments of that feel good back. But, you know, I realized that I've just got to let this do its thing because I know it's beneficial. You know, I know that it's going to have a great outcome for me. You know, so.
And you've been keeping up with your morning pages and everything like that?
Yeah, there was 2 days that I didn't do them. That's the first 2 days ever.
Oh, you know what's funny? I'm sure that if you read oh my gosh, yeah. It talks about... I was just rereading this last night. I have noticed that many tend to neglect or abandon the pages whenever an unpleasant piece of clarity is about to emerge. If we are, for example, very, very angry but not admitting it, then we will be tempted to say, we feel okay about that. The morning pages will not allow us to get away with this evasion, so we tend to avoid them. If we have the creeping feeling that our lover is not being totally honest with us, the morning pages are liable to bring this creeping possibility up, and with it, the responsibility for an unsettling conversation. Rather than face this mess, we will mess up on doing the morning pages. So, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Dave says in here, pain is normal and fine. Suffering comes from the resistance we put against ourselves.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yes, it does. That's all it is, too.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah. I think as you start to get more comfortable with the idea of having these, like, extreme emotions, the morning pages will make it easier for you to process them. So did you do them today, or was today one of the ones you avoided?
No, I did. But, you know, like I said, I didn't get up till 12, so I actually didn't. I was beating myself up about this for a while. For the last 2 weeks, I'm, like, not doing my morning pages until, like, 4 or 6 or 8 at night.
Oh, it doesn't matter. It doesn't
and
matter,
And I'm like,
honestly.
You've got to do it right when you get up. And so I decided, I wrote yesterday on my morning pages, I'm not going to beat myself up anymore about not doing them as soon as I wake up because it's not that important.
No, it's not.
So
honestly,
I actually did them.
Yeah. I mean, that was one thing that I had to let go of, like, the first little while, because my mornings are so unpredictable.
Exactly.
Sometimes my morning pages are my night pages, my afternoon pages, or whatever, but, like, just any time that you just have moments of still silence with yourself is really important, you know, that you're not being distracted, that you're not listening to music, that you're not, like, you know, having all this input around you. That's really why that she does it in the morning, is because, you know, you've already come out of sleep and you're not going to be, like, around a TV or around internet or whatever, you know?
Yeah, sure. And that, too,
you
is...
have
is,
that open space.
Yeah. And that, too, is why you do the, you know, meditation in the morning when you're so clear and ready and, you know, pave the way for the rest of the day. And so that kind of goes with it for me, doing the morning pages and in meditation. So... Mm-hmm. Right now it's coming at 4 or 6 o'clock in the afternoon, and I'm just going to be okay with that until it shifts naturally. That would feel much better. So,
yes, exactly. So this
I've always done mine at night.
Really?
I sometimes really like doing mine at night too, because that space before you go to bed, it's kind of like that mental dump before you go to sleep.
It's it helps you process the day and everything that's in it, right?
Exactly.
So I find it easier.
Yeah.
Oh, well, good. I'm not alone.
No, you're not. There's really no right way to do this process. I mean, there's tasks and assignments and stuff like that, but your flow, your pace is the best way to do it. You know, you notice that there's some people missing from the call tonight, you know? That's because they're at their own pace and in their own steps and their own journey.
Sure.
And I have no right to impose my will on theirs or tell them they need to follow this book like the Bible or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, because that's totally counterintuitive and totally opposite of the point that I'm trying to make. You know, too often.
Okay, Dave has...
Yeah.
Go ahead, sorry. What? Dave has another comment. It says, unless a terrorist insurgent is sticking a sharp object where they don't belong, then your suffering is caused only by you.
Hmm. Ever. Yep.
Yeah, so stop being a Nazi.
My own Nazi.
You are your own Nazi. It's okay.
Yep.
I've been my own Nazi, too.
Yeah.
So, Brenda.
Yes.
What have you been exploring?
For me, I guess, because I have... gone through this book once before, I got partway through it. It's just helping me pick up some of the things that I've missed the first time around, right? I'm actually able to be a little more freer with myself, I find, this time around. Freer, honest, I don't know what you want to put there, but it's like I said, it's been helpful, but, you know, I find that there's still, I don't know, there's, I guess, unanswered issues from my past and childhood and stuff that I have finally, I guess, started to get brave enough to ask my siblings about, right? So I'm in the process of of that at the moment. Mm-hmm. And so it has brought things up that I guess I wasn't expecting, but it's all because of this exploring, right? And trying to understand some of these things and where they're coming from. So it's been good. It's been really helpful in that way. So this morning I was up at 2:49, you know, awake and sitting there, and it's like all of a sudden, you know, things are popping into my head. It's like, okay, well, now here's another issue that I need to explore. So, you know, I got up really early and wrote an email to my brother and say, okay, you know, I need answers to this stuff. So it's been good. Don't get much sleep, but it's been good.
Well, you know, when we're going through stuff, I think our body just kind of naturally adjusts. Like, I know that when I'm going through something big, it's like my eating schedule and my sleeping schedule gets kind of wonky. But I don't worry about it because, you know, I just know that I'm going through whatever it is that I need to go through, and I'm not going to freak out, you know?
Mm-hmm. Not going to push it, yeah.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I don't know. And I think for me, the biggest thing, my sleep suffers when I'm going through these processes, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. But it'll work out. I'm quite confident in that. But at least I'm having, I guess, the guts to approach and ask the questions, whereas before it was like, yeah, okay, whatever, you know, you just kind of suffer in silence and just push on, right?
Which is the hallmark of what women with fibromyalgia do, right? You know, suffer in silence and just push on.
Yep.
Yeah, that's what we do.
Yep. And, you know, and I don't want to do that anymore, right? So.
No. Because you are a warrior, woman. I'm so proud of you for having that
courage. Some days, warrior or bitch, I'm not sure what the word is.
To some, maybe bitch, but to yourself, I hope you're feeling like your own champion.
Yeah, it's getting there.
It's getting there. It's a process. It really is.
It is. Yeah.
That's awesome. Oh, ladies. So how did your snowflakes look? Your life pie.
Mine hasn't changed much.
Yours has not changed much.
Oh, mine did.
No.
Mine did. It's it changed in the opposite direction though. Oddly. Let me find it. I don't know if this is even what it's supposed to look like, but week 4 is in pink. Mm-hmm. And so I was like, what happened? I guess it's... Is that even remotely close?
You're cocooning. It makes sense. You're cocooning. You know, like the caterpillar that needs to go through this process of cocooning before it can be turned into a butterfly?
Yes, you know, I relate.
my month of December was a bunch of cocooning. You know, I had all of these, like, lofty aspirations of what it was that I was going to do, but you want to know how I spent most of my days in December? Crying.
Yeah.
I was crying or grieving or writing or bitching or something. Like, I was just emoting.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I needed to do. It's exactly what I needed to do because I had all of this insight and awareness, and now January comes and I just cannot stop creating. Like, I literally,
awesome.
I just cannot stop. You know, I'm just in this flow of just, like I have so many pages, new pages in my book that's been written, and I decided to up and start writing my own book, and, like, you know, I've just been, like, having all of these processes. But if I had been judging the first 4 weeks, uh-huh. I wouldn't have gotten to the point of having, like, a breakthrough, you know?
Ah. I'm ready.
Dave said she is the walrus. Cuckoo cocoon.
Cuckoo cocoon. But no, seriously, like, all of the shit that you're going through right now, Happy, is all the stuff that you've avoided for years. Mm-hmm. And it makes sense that, you know, it's been a couple weeks of just weirdness because it's kind of trying to compensate for the couple years of weirdness that you've had. And yeah. The validation and, like, when you are laying down sleeping in bed and stuff like that and you are just there, what are some thoughts that are going through your head?
Oh, well, normally, though, I have meditation on, so that's kind of the guided meditation, so that stops all of that, because before it was like I couldn't go to sleep because so many things were coming at me, what I should be doing, what I got to do in the morning, and so for the last, we've been doing it for a good long time, we play the meditation all night, so as soon as that comes on, I don't have any more, you know, I just listen to that and start tuning into the words, you know, and I don't know if you're familiar with it, the guided meditation CD, the Abraham Hicks one, but on the nights that I guess too many things are going on in my head, it's just more about what's going on in my now, you know, what's physically manifesting around me that, you know, I would like to change, and it's getting a lot of my attention, and so, you know, just those personal things.
I have a question for Dave. Does Dave have any input about what Happy just said? Because I have some input, but I want to know if Dave is going to say it first.
He hasn't typed anything yet. Not at this time.
All right. I think that doing the whole guided meditation thing is totally good and everything like that, but I'm really interested in these racing thoughts. I'm really interested in all of the thoughts that are kind of barraging you and that you're running away from, because I think that the way that you're using your, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, I don't claim to be a know-it-all genius or anything like that, but to me, the way that it feels is that you're putting it on all night because you're afraid of these thoughts happening.
You know, I think it's more of an escape mostly, you know, so that I don't have to tune into it and acknowledge it.
Which is not what meditation is for,
right?
First of all. This is kind of like where there's like a bit of a spiritual New Agey trap, mm-hmm. and it helps us avoid what's actually going on, and then it kind of compounds and builds and builds and builds, and then you burst. And that you're experiencing that burst right now, but you're still trying to run from it, which is kind of why you're driving yourself a little crazy right now, is because, you know, you're in that bursting phase, and you're not just letting yourself burst. You're trying to, like, suppress it further and, you know, go away, go away, go away, you know? I'm going to think about my happy thoughts and go on my high-flying disc and go off to
jail. Yeah. Yeah. I know.
I did that for years, and it drove me batshit insane.
Right.
It drove me insane.
That's how it feels. That is exactly how it feels, and because that's what I was said when I first started this journey for myself. It was like, you know, there's only so much going into feel as good as you can that I can do, because it's so surface. You know, I want to go beneath the surface, and because there's so much more going on there. So I got a little confused in all of that wave of, you know, only think good thoughts, and I was like, hide who I really am.
you lost your authenticity.
Uh-huh.
You lost your authenticity, and now your authenticity is trying to come out, and it's trying to, like, rear its head and be like, hey, look at me, look at me, look at me, and you're still not looking.
Yeah.
You're getting glimpses of it, and you're like, oh my god, that's not appropriate. it's not appropriate. I can't look. Oh my god.
Yeah.
It's too much.
How funny. It's so true, though, because even I know that Abraham Hicks was coming through in March, and I was like, I'm going to ask them this question because it's driving me insane. I'm sitting here, you know, in a battle with myself because they're telling me one thing, and I'm feeling this other thing that I should be doing, you know, and they're telling me, just be happy. You're good. Get happy. And I'm like, I can't get there from here. What do I do? So, yeah, it feels so true. You know, this, it is a something that I do want to acknowledge it. So yeah, you're right. Just turn that down. Turn it. I noticed that today. I turned it off today when I woke up. Usually I leave it on all day. And I said, you know, I must not need the noise today. No distractions in my head. And it was real quiet in here. And I was able to think a lot, you know, of my own thoughts, which was like, well, okay, that's pretty cool. So
that's what's going on. I mean, the other is it's a form of brainwashing yourself.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, which is not a bad thing if it's, like, done in the right spirit. Like, I still listen to those Abraham Hicks guided meditations sometimes, but it's more so if I'm already feeling that way. Like mm-hmm. I'm kind of, like, I don't do it as an escape, because I learned a long time ago that if I'm doing that as an escape, there is something that I actually need to be sitting and thinking about. I need to sit and write about it. I need to express it first. Once I've expressed it, then I've given myself permission to actually go and, you know, listen to some Abraham Hicks or something like that. But I do not use that as a first resort, because you can't get from there to there.
Yeah,
you can't get from there from here.
Yeah.
So very, very first thing you do when you are upset is you write about it. You write
I'm going
all out. You
to create an interruption. Whoa. I'm going to create interruption.
Okay. What's up, Dave? He makes a big ordeal, and he doesn't even tell us what the interruption's for. I was saying something, man.
It was his last comment. Killer Davenport. Where did it go?
Dave, she doesn't know who Kyler Davenport is.
Sorry, I lost my whole screen, just went.
That's okay.
It keeps cutting in and out my chat, and I keep losing it.
Probably for the best.
Okay.
Dave.
What's that?
Dave likes to make inside joke comments that, like, really only he and I know about. It's, like, totally off topic. I mean, it makes sense to him and I, but you two don't know who Kyler Davenport is, nor do you want to.
Okay, he says here Kyler Davenport is the know-it-all
genius. The know-it-all
genius.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Anyways,
happy.
Where am I? Oh, and I said that it was hard to, he said, I'm glad that this isn't a quick comeback contest. And I said, sometimes it's hard to break in. He says, only as hard or not as you decide. It's not hard for me when my mic actually works. You're in a chat full of girls. You actually expect a natural break in the conversation? You may as well wait for gun bans to actually be effective. And I said, well, I don't want to break their flow. I said, they're so into it. And he goes, and that's a wonderful excuse to avoid expressing yourself. Give that excuse to Katerina and watch what she says.
Well, feel free, all of you, like, to conversation and stuff like that. I mean, this is a discussion. It's not, like, a monologue. So, yeah. I mean, I just wanted to finish up saying what I was saying to Happy, and then everybody is, like, you know, free to comment and everything.
Okay. We have no more breaks in the action.
Okay, cool. So, Happy, do you remember what I was saying? Because my memory got fuzzy. Just basically talking about, you know, writing it down first and giving yourself that permission to feel it, even if it's meaning that you feel like you want to kill somebody. You know, draw a picture of, like, a bloody severed head and go, like, and, you know, feel that relief. Feel that relief of being able to kill somebody on the page. It's,
you know, what scares me is that I think that it'll keep going in that direction and I'll get lost in that feeling place. That's why I quit. That's exactly why I'm like, no, I can't.
It doesn't. It actually just gets really funny and you're just like, oh my gosh, I'm drawing pictures of, like, bloody people and they're pooping each other's heads out. And, like, oh my gosh, like, this is silly, you know?
Yeah.
It gets to a point of silliness because you realize, like, how funny it is that you're drawing pictures of people being stabbed and you're just like, I feel like I'm five. I feel like I'm going to get in trouble. Like, the teacher's going to see this picture and get suspended.
Yes. That's what
that's when they call in the psychiatrist.
Yeah, there you go.
Say, Brenda. So,
I said, and that's when they call in the psychiatrist.
Yeah. So I'm like, I can't do that. I can't put it on paper anywhere. Somebody might see it.
Yeah. Well, I guess I just got really ballsy because I realized that I was tired of having that stuff inside of me. But, I don't know.
Dave says, don't eat the Pop-Tarts, you'll get arrested.
Pop-Tarts?
Yeah.
It's a joke. It's a joke from, yeah, Dave. Dave is funny. But no, it's
he
seriously.
Says, he says it's a news story, not an inside joke. International news.
Yeah, oh yeah, that's right. The kid got in trouble because he made a Pop-Tart gun or something. He like
what?
He bit into the Pop-Tart and made it look like a gun, and he held it up at a kid, and he got suspended or something.
Really?
Yeah. The kid was just a creative genius, but they're trying to think he's a killer.
Killer Pop-Tarts. Cool.
Yeah, Pop-Tarts. It's ridiculous.
Dave said, more than one kid, more than one school. More than one kid, more than one school.
Mm-hmm. Easy does it. Easy does it. I'm just looking at the last task of this chapter. And talking about, you know, looking at that one situation in your life that you feel like you should change but haven't yet. Like, what's the payoff for you staying stuck? Are you feeling, Brenda, like you're working through those? I mean, the way that you make it sound is like you've been really taking action and being really proactive about that kind of stuff.
Yes, I'm getting there. You know, there's, yeah, there's still certain, I guess, situations that, I guess, kind of make me feel stuck to a certain extent. But I don't, but at the same time, it's those situations where I just need to learn to trust in the circumstance and see where it takes me, right?
Yeah.
You know, some days it's frustrating, but then some days it's like, you know, I was thinking about that today, and it's just like, okay, yes, it is this, and it's this, and this, and this, and some days it just doesn't really work for me, but at the same time, I look at it, it's like, it feels that there's more to it, I guess, right? And I just need to sit it out just for a little longer and see where it's taking me. So I don't know if it's that I'm really stuck or how to...
Waiting for right timing and stuff like that. Waiting for the right time.
Maybe.
To kind of unfold.
Yeah, and it's just like, you know, those things I keep asking. I keep asking, like, why? Like, what is it about this situation? And I keep getting told, just patience, you know? That's what I'm hearing, is just have patience. So... You know, I guess I've always been the type of person to, in certain circumstances, be the person to make shit happen, right?
Yeah.
And now with this particular situation, it's kind of out of my hands and out of my control, and it's not so easy. So I guess I get frustrated and I feel like I'm being stuck, but I'm really stuck, right? I don't know if that makes sense.
No, it does. It really does. That patience part is really hard sometimes, especially when you're not the person that has immediate control over it.
Yeah, like I have zero control over this situation. Like zero. You know,
I take it so these kinds of things are showing up in your morning pages and stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Just talking about the situations and stuff.
Yeah. So, yeah, it's just, like, hold tight.
Well, at least you're getting good perspective on it and realizing that it doesn't have to be so painful because you're allowing yourself to have that patience.
Yeah, and I think that has been key for me is, you know, for 2014, I've decided that my word or my mantra for this year is trust, right?
Mm,
you know, I have a huge issue with that, you know, just trusting. And for many, many reasons, right? Past relationships, childhood, all sorts of things, right? And so, yeah, that's my thing for this year is just trust.
That's great. Happy, I think that resonates for you too. Me too, the trust.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
You know what's funny, Happy, is that I noticed on your life pie thing that your spirituality one, like, went, like, way down.
Did it?
Yeah, you made it look way down, but I think that's total bullshit, because what you're doing right now is spirituality. It may not look in the pretty, like, fluffy bunny pink rainbows and kittens kind of way of you thinking about spirituality, but real spirituality is a deepening in yourself and getting truer and deeper within being your real self.
Yeah.
And to be as close to that as possible. So I think that one was misrepresented, and that's a belief that you have about spirituality and what it's supposed to look like, and that's, I think, probably paining you right now, because you're in a bit of a dark night of the soul and you're not identified with this kind of spirituality quite yet.
Yeah, that is true. I can feel the realness of that. And, you know, probably all of those are misrepresented because the beliefs that I hold about each of them, you know.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it is a new becoming, I'll say. It really is. Transformation.
Dave says that you're a spiritual being having a physical experience.
Mm-hmm. Yep, it's true.
So, is there any thoughts either of you have? Anything you'd like to discuss about this chapter or anything beyond this?
You know, I did want to see what everybody's, what your favorite season was. I'm just curious.
Favorite season?
Yeah, and on task, what, number one?
Number one, yeah. And the environment as well.
Mm-hmm. So I was curious.
What about you, Brenda? I'll let you go first.
Oh, I'm definitely country. Mm-hmm. And all about summer. I hate winter.
I do too, and that's why I'm in Costa Rica.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can't handle the winter.
Oh, I hate it.
Winter sucked too, especially when I had fibromyalgia, because, yeah, it just stiffens your joints and your bones, and you just feel cold to your bone. It's just like, it's a really painful feeling. But
And this year, we're experiencing the most snow since 1920, so that's always awesome, too.
Wow.
Oh, God.
I love the snow, though. I just couldn't live there constantly in it. Just a visit here and there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But my favorite summer season is summer as well.
Is it summer? Mine is spring. Yeah. And I didn't realize it until this exercise, really. Because I was like, oh, I love all of them. But then when I started, what I did was I got pictures from different magazines, because I was like, I'm not going to draw it out, because I really am not, you know, feeling, like, confident in drawing yet. Mm-hmm. So I just took pictures that when I seen them, they felt good when I looked at them, as far as, you know, with seasons in mind. And then I pasted them all together in this, you know, on the task page. And so I was like, oh, okay, so it's spring. And I didn't write it anywhere, but I could see, like, you know, that it's springy. Very, I don't know if you could see that. Mm-hmm. Very spring-driven. Mm-hmm. So I was like, oh, that's fun. I didn't even realize. So So I guess, you know, it could be a bit of summer, but the new beginning, I think, is what really, you know, the everything's blossoming and becoming again, so. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Are you all...
What about your ideal environments? Like, do you prefer country, city?
Oh, definitely city. definitely city. The ocean. And that's another thing. I never realized how much I love the water. Doing these exercises really, you know, helps me to realize those things about myself. You know, that I never ask. You know, but yeah, definitely city, water, ocean. Let's see. There's so much written here. What about you, Katerina?
Well, I'm basically living in my ideal environment. Because I realized that about myself a long time ago, that I'm not happy anywhere else that's, you know, not tropical, that's not, you know, kind of more of a small, nature-y type town. Like I'm out here in the valley, and there's mountains on either side of me, and, you know, it's just, it does something to my soul that just enlivens it. And there's all this tropical flora and fauna everywhere, and it's just all so unique and beautiful, and... Yeah, like, this is my ideal environment right here. The weather doesn't get too extreme in either direction, and, you know, it's pretty temperate, and, you know, it's pretty ideal for me for creating and stuff like that. And it feels good.
Yeah, it feels good. That's what's important. It feels good.
Yeah.
It's good.
So that helps us to create, so, you know, from that vantage point, that feel good. Within
exactly. Yeah. I liked what you said, Happy, about talking about, you know, you didn't realize that there's all these things about yourself that you didn't really, like, know or think to ask.
Yeah.
But it's true, though, because oftentimes, like, we forget that we have, like, this I that can express. Mm-hmm. And, like, I was reading back over the chapter and everything, and it was talking about... you know, just the fact that in order for you to be able to make art, you first need to make your life, and you need to be able to really, the real art is your life, and creating that mm-hmm. life, and to have something that's worth living, and to really, to feel like the champion of your own life, and to feel like it's something that is beautiful, and interesting, and you know, that there's new experiences happening, and, you know, you're just really tapping into all of that. And with that, you create this individual, you create this identity, and from there you can express that identity. And I think something that I experienced, I don't know if you might be able to identify with this, Brenda and Happy, but, you know, when we go on this, like, spiritual path or something, we almost sort of surrender that. You know, we surrender that ego because we don't really want to, like, feel identified with, like, a personality or anything. And then we kind of forget about the things that we once enjoyed. We forget about the things mm-hmm. that we really used to love. And, you know, the 3D physical experiences that really brought us a lot of joy. And we kind of mm-hmm. shun it a little bit. We're just like, oh, it's almost like a spiritual anorexia in a way. I mean, that was something that I went through, and it was a really weird process for me to have to rediscover the person that I am, the person, the ego, that the personality that I have of, you know, the one that really likes doing things like watching movies on Netflix, and, you know, the person that does things that are very, you know, ordinary.
Yeah,
do either of you identify with that?
Yes.
Yeah. Like, I found with myself, like, I used to, like, listen to music huge all the time, right?
Yeah.
And probably for the last 2 years, I hardly ever have the radio on anymore. I hardly ever watch TV. I don't, mm-hmm. you know, it's just, like, a lot of that has just completely fallen away, right?
Yeah.
And just recently have I started listening to the radio again in the morning, but it's usually half an hour and that's it. And I don't know if it's because I can't handle all of the outside stimulation anymore and I prefer to be with myself and my thoughts instead of having all of this artificial whatever coming at me all the time. Mm-hmm. So
I went through that phase too.
Yeah.
That phase lasted about 2 years for me as well. And, you know, I knew it had a lot to do with just being sick and, like, not being physically well. Like, I don't know if you've experienced adrenal fatigue as well. But, yeah, like, that kind of thing. Like, I just could not listen to music or watch movies and stuff like that because it was just too much stimulation. But, do you feel like you just recently got sick, or have you been recovering for a while, or, like, what part are you in? Like, how do you feel?
Oh, I was diagnosed about 5 years ago.
Okay.
But probably, I would say, maybe the last 3 years were the hardest, right? Mm-hmm. Because I was working 16 hours a day type thing. You know, sometimes 7 days a week, which it just kind of kicked the living crap right out of me, right?
Yeah.
And so it just made things get a whole lot
harder,
worse, you know? And so I went into a burnout, and so I'm still recovering from that as well as everything else. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, it's been a long road, really long road.
I really empathize and understand that.
Yeah. So my hardest thing is the tired. Like, I feel physically drained all the time, right? It's just hard to wake up in the morning. You feel more tired than when you went to bed at night, you know? Mm-hmm. But, oh, well, I'll get through it sooner or later. But, while I'm speaking here, I thought I would jump in with Dave's environment that he wrote about here. So he's got summer/nature. Thankfully, Chicago has no shortage of nature. It's not the concrete jungle people portray it as. Imagine Portland. Now put the buildings a bit closer together than you might prefer them to be, but imagine that with lots of trees, bushes, flowers, and nature. That's Chicago, and that's why this year Katerina will be visiting during the summer instead of winter, when there's actually things to do and she sees that don't involve just my house or the inside of public buildings are freezing her ass off.
I've gone to visit Dave twice in Chicago, both of which times, the first one was in winter and it was really freaking cold, and then there was a second time and it was just like just the beginning of spring, and so that's what he's talking about and referencing. That's funny. So I think there's just a few more things that I want to cover before at least I feel like I can wrap it up, but did you do the reading deprivation, Brenda?
Yes. Yes. That wasn't really hard for me, because I didn't have a whole lot of energy this past week to do it anyway. So I was like, woohoo, I don't have to read.
That's awesome.
So, yeah, that was welcomed.
It's interesting, though, this whole process, and it's different than we kind of expect it to be, right? Because you get to tune more into how you're actually feeling and happy. You're tuning into, like, how tired you are and how exhausted you feel and, like, all of these, like, low feelings, these low energy feelings. Yeah. And, you know, Brenda, you're not a stranger to the fact that you've been feeling that way and you're just allowing yourself to kind of be in that.
Yeah.
I remember the first time that I went through this process, a lot of my morning pages were just like, oh my god, my back hurts so bad. Oh my god, I feel so bloated. Oh my god, I hurt all over. You know, just like these really monotonous, painful, just, you know, talking about the obvious, the things that I'm experiencing just physically, and, you know, my fingers feel so frozen. Like all of these really, like, gross, yucky things.
Yeah,
but there was something about it that felt really nice in actually being able to speak that, because it's like oftentimes people who are feeling like crummy, they don't really let themselves say it, or people view them as being complainers or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
But it kind of just alerts you to this, to the situations in your life that need the changing, and like, you know, the reasons in which you're being caused to feel this way, like, because, you know, the body is a very good transfer of feedback, you know, from everything else that's happening in your life. So
for me,
a lot of the stuff that I was experiencing was a lot of emotional and mental grief, because I had a lot of war just with myself physically. You know, I got to the burnout stage because I was an anorexic. And, you know, I was on heavy prescription medications, and there was, like, you know, behavioral meds that I took, you know, because I had ADD and, like, all this kind of stuff that created that physically, that environment for me physically, that high stress that broke me. And to cocoon and to reclaim that sense of myself again, it was a long, painful process in which I was really tired, but I realized that I was gathering energy and strength for the growth that I was partaking in, that it was not just all idle, that I wasn't just laying there in bed. Like, I was actually going through and reprocessing subconscious emotions and feelings and things, you know, that it was a very active rest. Do you experience that, Brenda? Like, you're going through stuff. It's not like you're just laying there like a zombie.
No, definitely not.
Yeah.
And it's so, like, it's interesting because probably about, I guess, 3 years ago now, I was having, like, severe abdominal pains, right? And so I had gone into the doctor, and they were thinking that maybe it was possible gallbladder or something, right? And I went through MRIs, and I did the whole shebang, and they couldn't find anything. And I went to see a lady that does, she's an intuitive healer, and she scans your body and all those kind of things, right? And I hadn't said anything to her about the physical issues that I was having, and she said to me, she says, you're having stomach problems. And I said, yeah. And she goes, you're experiencing this. And she goes, because you're very angry. And she says, and you have suppressed years and years and years of anger, right? Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking to her, and I'm like, what the hell are you smoking, lady? She goes, I'm not angry about nothing, right? Like, I don't know what you're talking about. Mm-hmm. And she goes, trust me. She says, once you release that, she goes, your stomach issues will go away. And I'm like, yeah, okay, whatever. And this is really kind of my first introduction to this whole thing, right? Mm-hmm. And that was a Friday. It was a Thursday or a Friday after work. And I didn't really think much of it. And then all of a sudden, you know, that weekend came around, and out of the blue, I started crying. And I had absolutely no idea what I was crying about. But the tears flowed all weekend. I couldn't stop it. I literally could not stop it. And I thought I was going crazy, right?
That's awesome.
And after, after I let it go, I have not had a single issue the same way. I have no idea what I let go, but, you know, whatever it was, whatever I was suppressing, you know, it disappeared. So I'm like, oh, you know. It's cool. So it's I think some of this stuff, you know, is there's still some of underlying issues, mm-hmm. which is adding to or creating some of the stuff that I'm still physically dealing with today, right?
Sure, yeah.
So
I want to share something, if that's okay with you. I mean, this is kind of a bit of vulnerable piece of information that I'm about to share, hopefully. I mean, I feel safe enough with all of you that I feel comfortable sharing it, but the pivotal point in which I realized, you know, I had been experiencing, you know, the fibromyalgia and everything like that, like those pain symptoms. It started as like 8 months of just back pain. And then my younger brother went to jail, and it turned into full body pain. It was just overload of stress, and like I just could not handle it, and my body just deteriorated really quickly. And the moment in which I was able to start experiencing moments of, you know, no pain, was when I had told my mom. I'm sitting here in this retreat house, and, you know, like, I had just gotten over, like, a four-day panic attack where I was like, oh, my God, because they had given me, like, medicines like gabapentin or whatever, and it was, like, mixed with, like, weed, and, like, I was just, like, off my rocker for, like, 4 days because I was just, like, I couldn't handle it, and my emotions had gotten to this, like, cataclysm point, and I just experienced like this tremendous just cathartic letting go where I was having a shift of realizations and perceptions really quickly, and it triggered like this weird, you know, 4 day period of time that kind of felt like 24 hours, but it was 4 days. And after that, you know, I spent about a week in a retreat house. You know, my mom's Catholic, and her Catholic friends agreed to host me there and stuff like that, and just let me kind of recover. But what happened was I started realizing some of the stuff that I had been suppressing, because it was coming up when I was in that four-day, you know, panic attack thing. And I was having flashes of memories from my childhood, you know, of my sister. My older sister was sexually abused by my father, and it ultimately tore our family apart and things like that, and it devastated me in such a way that I didn't really realize. And, you know, I kind of suppressed for a long time just this awareness that, you know, my sister had, you know, gone and done that kind of stuff to me too. And I was angry. I was really angry about that because I felt so violated as a kid, and that kind of stuff just really stayed with me. And, you know, she abused my other siblings too, and there was just like this big weird like cluster of it. And I never told my mom of everything that I had been through as a child. She only knew that my dad did that to my sister, but the anger that I was experiencing, the anger towards my siblings that I was experiencing, because, you know, it was all such a secret, and it was all such a an undercover thing, and no one talked about it, but it went on for years, you know? And I was so mad, and I didn't realize that I had still been holding onto that, carrying that with me, and it manifested itself as a pain. And so when I spoke it to my mother and told her everything, the pain, like, in that moment just like went away. Like, it was just, like, freaking miraculous. Mm-hmm. And from that moment forward, the pain just started lessening and lessening, because I was able to actually speak truth, and I was actually able to speak, you know, the experiences that I had as a child and the things that I had never told anyone, the stuff that I had felt repressed about. And from that moment forward, that was a really tremendous moment for me. So I just felt compelled to share that.
No, it's good, and it's amazing how that works, right? And like I said before experiencing it, you know, if somebody would have told me that, you know, a pain that you have is due to emotional, you know, pent up whatever energy, I'd have said you're full of shit, right? Mm-hmm. You know, a pain is a pain. It's got nothing to do with emotions. But, you know, it's until you've really experienced it, it's quite an amazing experience.
Yeah, it really is.
Oh, and Dave just kicked in and said, and then Katerina met me and didn't get headaches anymore because I was all the headache she needed. Ha ha ha, just kidding.
No, the funny thing is oftentimes if I'd have really bad headaches, because that kind of was coincided with the fibromyalgia, was I'd get these really bad headaches that were just really intense. But I realized that a lot of it happened because I was giving myself so much shit internally that I was creating so much just tension within myself because I was, you know, trying to be this positive spiritual person, but also simultaneously feeling really tight and just, you know, inside.
Yep.
And I didn't allow them to coexist. And I didn't allow myself to have my feelings, and I didn't allow myself to have my experiences. And so Dave would always make me laugh, and that's why, you know, his thing is, you know, paradigm shift and educational comedy, because his way of shifting people's paradigms is through comedy, because it allows people to sort of loosen up and, you know, allow whatever experience is happening for them to pass more rapidly because they're laughing about it and they're able to see it in a humorous light rather than something that's victimizing or painful or, you know, just,
right.
Yeah,
that makes sense.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
It is.
Dave, what do you say, Happy?
That's really awesome. I have an experience like you guys are talking about where when you feel that that relief, you know, of letting it all go, it's life-changing. And that happened to me about 3 years ago. And it's nothing, I never share it with anybody ever what went on. And I guess it's because I've suppressed it all this time. And it's like because I fear in sharing it that it'll bring it to surface for other people. So I have a real issue even now with that, allowing myself to tell that story and inspire instead of feel the opposite, like, oh no, it's going to hurt them or harm them in some way. But once I felt the relief of years and years, you know, accumulating of all, like my dad did the same to my sister, and it broke our family apart. And for years I was angry at her because of it, because I wanted my dad there.
Yeah.
And then I had this uncle who went around, you know, kissing all the young girls, and it was just like a crazy, I just associated myself with all of them because it just was nuts. And all of these things all of my life were just, you know, adding and adding to who I was becoming, which was like a recluse, because I'm like, you know, I don't want to be around anybody. Everybody's dangerous. You know, my mom always had this fear within me. Everybody's dangerous. Watch out for them. Even now she does this to me and I'm like, Mom, let me be, you know, I'm trying to recover from all of this. So, you know, about 3 years ago, I allowed myself to really let go of some things, and I disassociated completely with everybody for about a good 4 months. Like, my dad would come by, and I had a note on the door that says, don't even knock, because I don't want to talk to anybody, because I was in such a phase within myself that I didn't want to be around that environment with anybody. Mm-hmm. And the experience that I had, actually, all of us, my little family, we all experienced it because it was so detrimental to me that, you know, everyone was seeing it and everyone was experiencing this physical manifestation. And once, you know, I was very dominantly, this is my first time ever hearing Abraham Hicks, so it really played a key role in my recovery at that point. And once I was hearing it over and over that I am worthy, you know, all of these things, that I'm good, I'm loving, you know, because all these years I had thought I'm not any of those, I'm so unworthy, you know, because that's what I was experiencing. Mm-hmm. So the physical manifestation that came was very dominant. I mean, you couldn't miss it. It was from head to toe, it was my body, and it was insane. I'd never seen anything like it. And you didn't want to get out of bed. You couldn't, really. Everything was painful. And so once I let that all go and did that, really just cocooning, didn't talk to anybody, didn't go anywhere, just told myself, you know, the affirmations over and over until I started to almost believe them, you know, that I could feel every day lighter and lighter and lighter. And then when it really happened, when it really shifted, we were driving in the country, and I was hearing it, Abraham Hicks, Now We Are Free. And it's my favorite one because of this experience that I had when we were driving in this country. So all we see is hay, and I look over and I see like my life, the life that I had previously up to this point, all like flashed before me. I mean, like, seriously, it just like played out, and it was like, that's over now. Now you can move forward. Now you can become you. And I felt like just exactly how it feels to be in a cocoon and be a butterfly becoming, you know, spreading your wings and becoming that butterfly. And so that was a really big shift in my life, you know, just that 3 years ago, to be where I am now. And so that's why this is a big journey for me, and it's been going on for some time. But letting that go and then realizing that all of the physical manifestations that had become my life for about a good almost year were gone completely. No, it was about 2 years. And it was like people were saying, oh, you'll never get over that. That's going to be there for the rest of your life. That is who you are now. And it's like, no, I feel within me. You know, there's so much more. And so when I let all of that go and started to believe in myself and believe that I am worthy and that I have a purpose, my body started to believe it too. And then my body began to heal and be so vibrant, and then all of my families did the same. And so life really shifted, and then we moved to California, you know, which was a dream to me. We were living in a little tiny town for so long. And so, yeah, the relief, I can hear, you know, both of your stories, and I can feel the relief, you know, when you let that go, your body really feels it. Your body really responds. Mm-hmm. And so now when we tell all of us, we say to each other, you know, my cells are perfect. My body loves me. I love my body. You know, these things that we tell ourselves because it feels good, and we know it to be true because of our experience, you know. So I just wanted to to put that out there too. You know, it's not something I share with anybody ever, but I could feel the relief just now from sharing it. So I think it's been pent up in me up till this point. So thank you for letting me share it with you guys.
That's awesome.
That is awesome. What was the physical manifestations that you had?
They were just I don't even want to say what the physical name of it is. It's just a physical manifestation. It's not something that I like to ever talk about, I guess. You know, I can feel it when I'm saying this. I'm like, oh, this doesn't, you know, but it's a, what they call the staph infection.
Mm-hmm. Oh, staph infection. My mom had it years ago.
Yeah, I had it too. I had like huge cysts all over my face that were just like crazy huge. That was during that period of me, you know, coming out of anorexia and stuff like that. Like my body was just so out of whack that like I was unrecognizable. Like, you know, I didn't look like myself. It was painful.
Very.
And I had braces on top of it. Like, did you have it all over your face and stuff?
Everywhere. Head to toe, everywhere.
All over my back, all over my chest, all over my sides, all over, you know, everything. Yep. Been there, done that, happy.
Yeah, it's just something that, and when you're around people who don't believe in you or believe in anything, because we didn't take medication. Because I've never been, at that time I was very herbal. so we would drink garlic And, you know, it was like we were making ourselves believe the garlic was working when I knew fully that it was an inside job. So yeah. It was like, you know, I've got to come to a better place within myself. You know, there's some things going on in there that I'm not letting myself or anyone else see. And until I do, I'm not going to get anywhere because Abraham Hicks is telling me so. You know, that's the first time I've ever heard of them. So, yeah. You know, it was a true awakening. And now to be, you know, and now to be at this point where I feel like, man, I'm just now getting my wings, and I didn't even realize. I thought back then I was getting my wings to fly, and I can really feel it, that I'm becoming, you know, more of who I came here to be, you know, the true being that I really am, you know, that I'm not hiding behind because all these people say you should do this or do that or be this person.
Oh, gosh, I know I totally know that, because it's like, you know, when you're in that phase of being so sick and so, like, you know, you feel flawed and you feel, like, just imperfect and you feel, like, not okay, it's really hard to feel confident enough to, like, stand up for yourself in front of other people and to be like, I know what is right for me, even though, you know, they're like, well, no, you don't. You still have the problem.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. Yeah, that's the truth. And then, you know, for them to see us, well, none of them have seen us. You know, I'm talking about my family, really, because that's who I was around. They haven't seen us since then. They haven't seen the person that was recovered except for in pictures. And they're just like, wow, you know, we didn't think that was possible, you know. And
same for me.
So it feels really good, but at the same time, I'm like, you know, to share it with people or anything. It's just a road to recovery, really.
But do you see, though, how, like, invalidating that? Like, the fact that you just shared that with me makes me feel less alone in, like, what I've been through? Because you probably wouldn't have even ever guessed that about me, right?
Like, never.
You probably would have never known that about me, that we have shared similar paths. And, like, the fact that, you know, it's so funny that you had that experience and then Brenda and I had the same experience with fibromyalgia. So it's like,
exactly.
You know, I would have never known that unless we had talked about it and been vulnerable, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I do. I feel that. And that's one of the things I think that I'm coming to grasp more and understand and feel more, that it's okay to be who you are. And it's okay to share that person that you are, because it inspires and helps other people. And that's ultimately what I believe, you know, is one of my purposes, is to do that. It's just I'm so wrapped up in being afraid to do it. So, you know, it's a journey, though. It really is. It's just a journey. And it of becoming, you know, becoming who I, because when I was a kid, I knew these things, and I loved bright colors, and I loved just expressing who I was and doing the things I loved to do. And then as I got older, you know, and the poems I used to write originally, they used to be, you know, whatever I was feeling, no matter if it was good or bad. But over time, people kept saying, you shouldn't write that. You should not be writing those things. Look how horrible that feels. You know, and I'm like, oh, okay. So then I stopped writing poetry completely, you know, so that no one could see those feelings. No one would be able to look at it and say, hey, that's not how you should be feeling. You should be a lot happier than that, or you should do this thing or that thing. You know what I mean? So
I stopped now you're writing. Kind of using spirituality as that paternal, like, dogmatic viewpoint and being like, wow, well, you know, I just wrote this and I just drew this. I shouldn't really be drawing that or writing that because it's not spiritual, and I shouldn't write that. And oh gosh, I'm gonna get in trouble.
Yeah.
You know, like that.
Exactly.
Kind of thing.
What a feeling. Yeah.
Yeah.
And you know, I wouldn't have known all of this up until now, because I just keep putting it off and putting it off and pushing it to the corner and saying, no, that's not me. You know, and doing whatever I could to feel good. That's it. Instead of addressing it and becoming, I was just shunning it away and just, you know, I'm just going to feel good, you know, and that's it. So, whew, what a path.
Probably feels a little bit relieving, though, because you realize you don't have to be perfect. You don't have to be super duper happy all the time, even though your name is happy.
Yeah, you know, and that's a little bit of a stressful thing, too. You know, it's like, gosh, really?
Everyone expects you to be your name.
Yeah, and you know, most often, you know, like I said, even as a kid, I was really happy, but life started to shift, and you know, I think it has its purpose. I mean, I know it does, for me to experience all of that up until now so that I could,
you know. Hang on just a second.
Okay.
Just 1 second, I'm sorry. What's up? Okay. Yeah. I can definitely tell them for you. Yeah. And you're in the which room? The middle room. The blue room?
The green
room. Okay. Okay. Cool. Yeah. I'll tell them. You're welcome. Okay. Sorry about that.
No, no worries. Oh, good.
Okay. There's Dave.
Or wait, what was?
Sorry, I was going to. Dave said that there is something on Happy's Facebook wall so she can laugh about all this spiritual stuff. And what I posted resonates with her current rant.
I'll check it out. Thank you, Dave. Yeah, I see. I'll check it out.
Dave says you're welcome.
I'm curious.
You'll have to check it out, too.
So you were saying something, and I got derailed by German people that want to stay another night.
Aw, they love it so much there.
They do.
That's
probably
because
I'm really social with them, and I talk with everybody here, so everybody's been staying longer.
Wow.
It's good for business.
Awesome.
For,
like, yeah.
For the people who own it.
I would say, yeah, definitely. Let's see. I don't remember what I was saying, but I was just looking over notes. I was curious. I don't remember what I was saying a while ago, but I was curious what your artist date was this week, both of you.
My artist date. I've had quite a few, actually. And a lot of them have just been kind of internal things, like, you know, going around to places on my own around here, because, you know, sometimes I get scared of doing that because I'm, you know, a foreigner, and I'm just afraid to, like, go see things on my own and do things on my own, because it's not necessarily the safest thing is to go by myself.
Yeah.
But, like, even small little things, like just spending some time out in, like, the patio or something like that, or spending time out in a hammock and just kind of having that time to myself.
Yeah.
And to just be there and, you know, have my artist date with my laptop and my paintbrushes and stuff like that, and just to have that space for a rendezvous with my creatives has been really fun. You know, so I've been making an effort every single day to be making that special playtime for me and my artist.
Awesome.
Just to get together and have some tea and just chill out. And do that kind of stuff. So I haven't really been, like, going out to go, like, do cool, fun things like that, but I've definitely been having a lot of, like, you know, one-on-one stuff where I'm, you know, sitting down and, like, painting, you know, like that kind of stuff.
Yeah. Yeah.
So what about you, Brenda?
I just, in spite of the fact that it's cold and yucky, I was outside taking pictures.
Oh, cool.
And I used to take a lot of photos, right? I was into the whole photography thing there for quite a few years. And then, yeah, it was kind of another one of those things that just kind of dropped away, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so people have been encouraging me to get back into it. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, I went out for the first time the other day and took some pictures.
That's awesome. That's very awesome.
How did it feel?
It was good. I enjoyed it. It's always really cool to, I guess, to see the world through the lens of a camera, right?
Exactly.
That's what I had enjoyed about it so much the first time, is because, like, it's, you know, you can never recapture that moment, right? Mm-hmm. It is what it is, and it will never be the same again. So that was one of the things that I found really, you know, compelling about photography. So it was nice to experience that again, you know. Just, like, we're, if everything goes smoothly, my son and I should be moving down to Minneapolis in April. And so part of it was just to be able to, I don't know, just kind of capture the area and kind of preserve some of the shitty snow that I'm glad to be leaving behind. You know? Yeah. But, yeah, it was good.
That's very cool. Yeah.
Okay. I used to... Are you happy?
I was going to say to Brenda, I used to take pictures a lot when I was younger, and over time I think I stopped doing it as much because other people were judging it so much, and just being true to what happened. And even just a few years ago, someone bought a book because they thought I should be taking them this particular way, and that, you know, because I was experiencing, like, what I seen through my eyes, so if I tilted my camera, that's what I wanted to see. And so many people were like, that's not photography, you know. And so I just stopped doing it, and because people were, you know, giving me that feedback. And so now that I'm taking it up again, I'm doing it and saying, you know what, this is for me, you know. Yeah. And anyone that I share it with will be, you know, those who are appreciating it, rather than, you know, saying it should look like this or this, you know, here's this book, you need to look at this. And it's like, you kidding? I've been taking pictures all my life. But, you know, I experienced that complete drop and saying, I don't even want to take pictures. I don't even like pictures anymore. because of other people's thoughts about it, you know. But reclaiming that and then doing it more and more and more, oh, it feels so good. It feels so life-giving to take what you actually love back and start doing it for you. So... How cool that you're doing it.
Yeah, and I find that with, like, artwork in general, right? You know,
yeah.
even some of the stuff that I do now, like, my family will look at it as like, what's that supposed to be? It's not supposed to be anything.
Exactly. Right? I get that too. Yeah.
It's just what I've done, okay?
Yeah, it just is.
Exactly. Just be in the moment, right?
Yeah. So, exactly.
Photography kind of allows you and gives you that opportunity. Like, you just, you know, everything is about being in the now and the moment, and, you know, pictures can do that for you, right?
Absolutely. Yeah, definitely. Absolutely.
Yeah.
In real life moments, I love to capture, like, what's really happening, you know, and people being themselves, doing, you know, things that they normally do every day. You know, and some people are like, you shouldn't do that. You should not be taking pictures of those people.
Why not?
You know, I don't know. But I want to. Craziness. But my artist date, you know what I did? I just sat in front of the computer for... Well, one day, I had to split it in 2 days because it was a six-hour thing. But the first day was New Year's Eve, and I just watched for the first time the ball drop. And I was so inspired by that. It just, my mind was racing with all these cool things that I'm going to do next New Year's Eve. And I finished watching it the next day, and all by myself, I'm in front of the computer, and I'm like, oh, you know, all these awesome things go on that you don't even know, you know, that happen to make that happen. So I was just, you know, just wowed by how awesome that process is, you know, putting that together and the people that come there and what they experience and how they were feeling and watching the ball drop and just all the colors. It was so it was thrilling. And I think it was the best one I've had yet, best artist state I've had yet.
That's cool.
Very cool.
Dave said to say hello to Grayson. Did you hear that?
Grayson?
Who's Grayson?
Yes, you're supposed to say hello to Grayson.
Hi, Grayson.
He asked me on Skype what I was up to, so I gave him the streaming link. Do I need to unmute?
Oh gosh, we have an audience, ladies.
Hello.
I don't know how I feel about that. No, it's okay. It's all right.
I did have a question, Katerina, on, and I've lost where it's at. When it says to, oh, here it is. Plan a small vacation for yourself for an extended artist day. Mm-hmm. My mind went blank. I'm like, what is it talking about? That was a vague thing for me to read. So I'm wondering, I have written ideas. That's all I wrote, ideas.
So, go to the beach. Go to the beach for a day, just you. You know, like, just you. Just you all by your lonesome and go off and just go do something fun that you don't let yourself do. Maybe go have a spa day or something, like, you know, something that is just for you. You don't have to take your husband. You don't have to take your kids. You don't have to take anybody. Just you.
Okay. That's a good one. I'm going to do that. You know, we went to, for the first time I experienced San Francisco the other day. And I was like, wow, it was so awesome. I mean, we didn't stay, well, we were there for a little bit under not that awesome circumstances, but the feeling of being around all that just was, there was the beach right in front of me and then all these huge buildings everywhere, and it's just like, oh, I love the city. Mm-hmm. So that really, I could feel that. I'm like, I've got to come back very soon. So I think a good one just popped in my head to go have coffee in San Francisco, where I could see the bridge and see the beach at like a Starbucks. So that sounds good to me.
Yeah, or even like stay there for the night and like kind of just give yourself like a day out of it. You know, I think that's what it's saying, is more of like an extended artist date, like a small vacation for yourself. You know, even if you just like stay overnight, like go couch surfing, even if you have like some friends there or something, like, you know, you can sleep at somebody's house or do whatever you want to do, and just
Well, that
have an experience out of it.
All right. Go have something. Okay, I think that was my last question out of all of this. All of this week.
What about you, Brenda? Any questions?
No, I don't think so.
Sweet. Well, ladies, I am quite tired, so I'm going to have to call it an evening for myself. But, I really appreciated everybody getting together and, you know, talking, and I'm quite happy with how this is turning out, and,
Me too.
Yeah, it was good.
I have a lot of faith in both of you and all of us.
Yeah, I'm thrilled. I really am. Even though I'm like, ah! I want to read.
It's all part of the process.
Oh.
All right. I'll see you all next week.
Sounds good.
Can you hear me? Okay.
Do either of you have any any plans you would like to tell me about beforehand for next week, if you know of them yet?
I don't know of any.
I don't think I have anything, but I just need to cut in here for a second for Dave.
Okay.
Grayson asked exactly what this whole thing was about. Katerina, please briefly explain.
Oh, okay. Grayson, this is a group that I put together for artists who are recovering or newly wanting to be inspired and engaged, but we are working from the book called The Artist's Way, and we have discussions about some of the concepts and ideas that are in this book, and all in all, it's all about, you know, becoming your deepest self and to allow that to shine through so you can make really amazing artwork and you can live a more creative and fulfilling life. And that is kind of the premise of what it is that we are doing here. So I hope that kind of was nicely put in a nutshell for you. I don't really know you. I don't know how to present this to you. that is the best that I can do, because that is how I presented this to these ladies, these sweet, kind ladies right here.
Yeah, that was perfect.
We are embarking on this journey together.
Yes.
So, did Grayson respond? I don't know.
I haven't got anything back yet from Dave.
Okay. But right now, Grayson, I'm really tired, because I have been awake since like 5:30 this morning. It's 9:30 right now.
Oh, wow.
Sleepy time indeed.
Dave is, all right, ladies, Dave said nothing back yet.
Okay, well, I'm sure that he'll text chat it to me when I get off the call. But keep it up, ladies. I'm really happy for all the progress that's happening for both of you.
For all of us. Awesome. So we'll see you next.
Next Sunday at 7, if you can. 7 Central.
Okay.
So that's 5 p.m. for you, Happy, and then 6 p.m. for you.
I don't know why I thought it was 6 yesterday. I was like, yeah, it's 6 o'clock. So, wow. But so next Sunday at 5, we'll be there.
All right.
All right. All right.
Good night.
Have a good night, ladies.
Good night. Sweet dreams.
Bye.